Shunji Iwai is one of Japan's most fascinating directors. His portfolio is full of touching romanticism, juxtaposed with a streak of cruel reality. The leisurely moods his wistful tales conjure tug on a nostalgia we can't possibly know, but to know it we do. And when Iwai speaks of tragedy, it's offset by a lightness of touch and an eye for heart-rending sweetness. After 30 years as a filmmaker, he's still arguably finding his voice. But what a wonderful search it has been. Love them or hate them, his movies cut to the heart of the human condition, optimistic and pessimistic in equal measure, presenting ethereal beats of beauty found in the bemusing, carving poetry from pain and purity alike, and often asking nothing more of his audience than to sit in a stunningly captured moment. Many of Iwai's features are lengthy affairs. It's a habit that is simultaneously the director's greatest strength and weakness. As someone who made a name for themselves with music videos and straight-to-TV short films, it could be argued his leisurely style was forged as a rebellion of sorts to those precisely timed productions, his two-hour-plus runtimes an excuse to exercise a newfound freedom. I can't stand unnecessarily bloated movies, but a film can commit no greater sin than feeling like it's in a rush, spoiling its scenes as it trips over itself to get to the next one. Iwai, at least, never makes that mistake, though he has tested my patience on more than one occasion with a piece that should have ended half an hour before it did. Across his entire body of work, Iwai has championed the value of moments, allowing his characters to simply exist in front of a camera, to live in a scene. And these moments are examples of cinema at its most sublime. He often chokes on the balancing this ebb and flow demands, but the fact that he is forever chasing it makes him a director I can't help but adore. Much of his work is obsessed with youth, with the ethereal yet profound nature of that fleeting chapter in our lives. The astounding hour-long mood piece, April's Story, a personal favourite, is a gentle look at leaving home for the first time, and the joys and pitfalls that come with such newfound freedom. Love Letter is a peek at loss and grief under an unrelenting blanket of snow, years removed from the rose-tinted pictures of our past. And Fireworks directly addresses how everything can hang on the inane, where our futures are balanced on a precarious state of flux. But there's a darkness to Iwai too, who is eager to pick apart the chaos of such tumultuous years, to explore how redundant it is to try and control that chaos, and how foolishly we try to control it anyway. He sits in the fallout such a battle leaves in its wake, and pokes at the embers until we, as viewers, realise how uncomfortable we are with their familiarity. If this all seems a bit fanciful, you need go no further than to check out his wildly upsetting and weirdly uplifting All About Lily Shushu, a vicious film about a generation of kids raised by celebrity, by media, and by the terrifying anonymity of the internet. The disassociated youth present on the reel are fascinated, as many kids are, with pulling the wings off insects. Only, in an age where our strongest relationships exist through a monitor, where text is power, and causing pain is easier than ever, the insects are each other. In the face of such darkness, Iwai doesn't flinch, but luckily, he has a similar eye for the goofiness of childhood, the joy of it, and in Hana and Alice, he zeroes in on something altogether more hopeful than what had come before. Hana and Alice are two quirky schoolgirls brought beautifully to life by Anne Suzuki and Yu Aoi. Debuting in a series of shorts Iwai made for the 30th anniversary of KitKat, he he went on to expand these shorts to a feature film, a movie that has all the time in the world for friendship and fun. Whilst Hana and Alice is categorised as romance, drama, or a coming-of-age story, it's rarely labelled as the comedy it clearly is, the comedy it has to be, for you to look past the bizarre story of a man banging his head and being convinced by a passerby that he has amnesia and that she's his girlfriend. It's a weird framing device, one that gets weirder the deeper you get into the two-hour tale, but it's full of laugh-out-loud moments thanks to the talent of our two leads. Indeed, the film is carried by their over-expressive faces and wonderful comic timing, and you soon realise the various storylines play second fiddle to the chemistry of Hana and Alice. In a portfolio full of striking moments, one of Iwai's most memorable occurs late in the film, one that stopped me in my tracks and seemed to recontextualise everything that had come before. The movie is a troubled one, speaking as much to the hilarious innocence of our youth as it is the stupidly selfish things we can do in the blindness of it. And yet here, nestled in the climax of an often ugly tale, is a moment of arresting beauty. Neither unearned nor out of place, Iwai reminds us of the importance of balance, of never drowning in a film's misery, or escaping into its unreality. It's that delicate balance that Iwai has been tuning his entire career. When our deuteragonist Alice cobbles together point shoes out of paper cups and duct tape and springs for the first time up into relevé, the world, and the last 2 hours of lying and deception and ugly humanity melt away. For a wonderfully extended 4 minutes and 45 seconds, Shunji Iwai lets this moment breathe, and in doing so, we almost forget to breathe ourselves. 10 years later, Iwai returned to the world of Hana and Alice with a prequel of how our heroines met. Their decade of absence is immediately apparent, with the film's mix of CGI and rotoscoped animation covering up the aging of its original cast, and giving us a beautiful aesthetic as a byproduct. But it's in Iwai's ever-evolving grasp of breathable beauty that this picture proves how far those involved have come in the intervening years. It boasts a script bursting with similar set pieces, with each arc in the film standing on its own as a keenly aware snapshot of youth and friendship, of drama and regret, of love and Kit Kats. In a shrewd move, much of the periphery features of Hana and Alice fall away in its prequel, leaving us with their wonderful chemistry to instead serve as a centrepiece to a storyline full of their goofy hijinks, pushing them through a light-hearted comedy of errors as they quickly become fast friends, free of the melodrama that weighed their initial outing down somewhat. What starts as a simple tale of a girl transferring schools and feeling thoroughly out of place quickly devolves into a murder mystery misadventure, with the whereabouts of the previous occupant of Alice's new desk becoming a rabbit hole that's so much fun to fall down. Despite starting with an exorcism, it's a movie that's strangely relatable, thanks in no small part to the animated tics and habits that an artist might forget, but a camera doesn't miss. That's part of the appeal of rotoscoping. As alien as the finished product often feels amongst its animated contemporaries, tracing live-action footage imparts a strong sense of genuine humanity onto the characters caught in its frames. It lends a unique tempo rarely found in animation, and whilst I'm usually indifferent to the technology, it comes into its own in a picture that's as full of character and as reliant on comic timing as this one. Iwai's films are usually packed with avant-garde storytelling, with disconcerting camera work and cinematography striving to mirror those disarming tales. In the case of Hana and Alice, his narrative beats are atypically playful, free from the thorns so much of his library conceals, and the look and feel of the film again match this tone. It pops with a bright and colourful aesthetic, its warmly lit backgrounds awash with vibrant hues, and its unique animation fun and free-spirited. There's an energetic life to the feature, birthed in equal parts by the rotoscope technology and the dorky leads it captures, now matured actresses slipping effortlessly back into the roles they clearly loved so much. It may be a prequel to that barbed original, but in many ways it feels like an evolution, of its fleshed-out characters, of its carefree themes, and of the director at the helm of it all, someone in control of their voice, of their vision. The movie is full of erratic moments of youth, of racing for the last train, or doing a terribly conspicuous job at playing detective. But it's also anchored by a touching sentimentality, a brief scene that cuts effortlessly to the heart of a strained father-daughter relationship, a guilt-ridden recluse braving the outside world for the first time in years. Iwai's balance exists here purer than most of his live-action joints, at a relatively brief 100 minutes, and it's an hour and a half full of laughter and warmth, with not a minute wasted. It's a movie full of the moments that made Iwai, allowed to exist, and to exist in, but it's so different to what had come before for one of Japan's most curious directors, and it couldn't have been made by anyone else. Like much of Iwai's portfolio, it wasn't hard to fall for the Case of Hana and Alice. A love that happened in a moment. As always, thanks for watching. This piece was originally created in response to Joe Yang's November challenge, in which he asked YouTubers to make a video about an anime that is currently underrepresented on the platform. My mind instantly went to the warm and wonderful Hana and Alice, a film I rarely hear anyone talking about from one of my favourite directors. I'm really pleased I finally had the chance to recommend it to all of you. It's a great place to dive into Iwai's wider library of works, and see if that strange portfolio is for you. We're really close to funding the Fullmetal Alchemist video on Patreon, so if you'd like to chip in and see that project hit the channel, consider heading over and pledging a buck. If, instead, you'd like me to get amnesia so you could convince me I was never a YouTuber, hit the like button, and I'll refuse to mind my head when prompted.